Namaskar and hello and welcome to P Guru's channel. I'm your host Sri Iyer. Today I have a brand new guest, an author of three books on Pakistan, Tilak Deveshar. Tilak ji, namaskar and welcome to P Guru's channel.
Namaskar. Thank you so much for having me.
So before I make any mistakes, I want to read out Tilakji's background. He is an author of three acclaimed books on Pakistan, a former special secretary in Cabinet Secretariat, Government of India, and till recently, a member of the National Security Advisory Board. I have looked at his titles. I have not read his books, but they are very, very interesting. Very few people from India have written three books on Pakistan. One of the titles, Tilakji, really piqued my interest. Pakistan, Courting the Abyss. We're going to talk a little bit about the construct called Pakistan. And I want you to kind of walk our viewers back to the time, perhaps in 1940s, when, you know, the tremors were there that there is going to be a separate country, but people are not taking it seriously because you had democratically elected governments in Sindh and Punjab, which are the main states. And yet somehow, when the partition indeed happened, it came as a shock. From what I have read, from little I have read, the way the administration was done in much of what is now Pakistan and Bangladesh, much of the administration was in the hands of Hindus. Even law and order perhaps was in the hands of Hindus. But when this happened, they were forced to, at least those who could afford to, forced to leave with whatever clothes they had and flee to India. Now, this is my reading. I could be wrong. So perhaps you could take us back to 1946. And we're going to take a look at what exactly is this construct, why this construct is artificial and cannot sustain, and why it is proving that again and again, over and over. Over to you, Tilakji.
Thank you very much. Very interesting question. Actually, I would even go back further.
Yeah.
This construct called Pakistan actually began due to the feeling of insecurity that a section of the Muslims started developing in North India, a minority section, that they were losing power due to the gradual decline of the Mughal Empire and the coming into power of the British and a representative government of one person, one vote, which meant that the Muslims would actually become a minority. These people in the small minority felt that now they would really become a minority because the Hindu majority would outvote them in a representative government. It is this feeling of insecurity that led first to the 1906, you know, using the British sort of pandering to the Muslims by partition of Bengal, setting up of the All India Muslim League. The journey starts from there. It is this Muslim insecurity which later on Jinnah was able to capitalize, and then you had the Lahore Resolution of 1940, which was passed into creating a separate thing. He articulated this concept that Hindus and Muslims were two separate nations and the Muslims needed their own homeland. And this actually was a very weak foundation for creating the state. Because as Maulana Abdul Kalam Azad pointed out, neither does Islam nor does the Quran anyway talk about an exclusive land or a country based on Islam. It is the entire, whatever the population, believers, non-believers, Muslim, non-Muslims, who constitute the Qaum. But Jinnah insisted that no, it is only, you know, the homeland for the Muslims. So these were the very weak foundations on which Pakistan started off. And then, you know, as we go along in this conversation, I'll point out other facets which have led to a very weak construct for what Pakistan is, as in why it is an artificial state. But the starting point is this feeling of insecurity among a section of the Muslims in North India that they were going to lose out and become a minority.
I've also read elsewhere, and some Muslim friends of mine have confirmed this, that up until 1905 or 6, when the All India Muslim League Party was formed, the Muslim brothers and sisters of ours, they used to do Pitru Tarpan. You know, when you remember our departed once a year, whether it is our mother or our father, they used to do this thing too. And suddenly, this 1905, this formation of this party, perhaps then the partition of Bengal, somewhere they started feeling that, no, we should not do that. Now, my question to all of those who are not doing it now is, you know, what is wrong in trying to remember our parents? Because they are what made us what we are today. Anyway, that is just a topic that, but the other data point I had was, I remember that Jinnah had actually retired from politics and he had retreated to England. I think it was 1930 or 31. I don't remember the exact year.
And well, after the 37 elections, yeah.
Okay. So then, so a bunch of Muslim kings, princes, whatever you want to call them, they started resettling into what is now Pakistan. And then that sort of one thing led to the other. I don't know how true that is. I think I read that in Freedom at Midnight, if I'm not wrong. I could be wrong about that. But I remember reading something like that. So maybe you can dwell upon that also, because Jinnah was pretty much done with politics. He was done with everything. He had just gone back to England, right?
Yeah. Actually, he went because he knew that he did not have a future in politics. And he went and started practicing law and had a pretty flourishing practice over there. He was actually brought back. People say it was Iqbal. Other people say, actually, one person whom people don't talk about is actually Ahmadi, who persuaded him to come back. The British too had a role in his coming back because, you know, they were coming up with the 1935 Act, more provincial autonomy, more powers to the provinces. So they wanted some person to come back and to make sure that you could lead the Muslims and not leave everything down to the Congress party. That's how he actually returned. He made two or three trips to India over a period of 2-3 years, then finally decided to move back into India. And when he came back, then he changed his costume. Instead of his Savile Row suits, he started wearing the Achkan and he started wearing the Karkuli cap and, you know, changed his entire demeanor so as to be able to play the Muslim card. So that was the thing, that he was actually brought back. He didn't want to come back himself, but he was brought back on persuasion, possibly by the British.
So kind of take us back to 1945, 1946. The British were still in power. The Second World War had ended and the British were beginning to carry out trials of people, soldiers who had deserted the British Army and joined the INA of Subhash Chandra Bose. And then the nation suddenly woke up and there's this conflicting thoughts going through the nation. Why are you doing this? In fact, I know my grandfather used to work in the Navy, that there were mutinies in the Navy, especially in Mumbai as well as in Karachi. And this sort of told the British that, okay, we cannot hang around here anymore and we need to move. Paint us a scenario of what was happening at that time.
See, let's go back to 1939. When the Second World War broke out, Congress was in power in majority of the provinces. But Congress resigned in protest against Britain taking India into war without declaring war aims or without consultations. This was the opportunity that Jinnah pounced upon, because the entire Congress leadership was in jail and the British depended on the Muslim League to organize recruitment for the British Indian Army to fight in against the Japanese and fight against the Germans. That was the opportunity, and the British then realized that Jinnah could be a very faithful sort of a person who could be used to further British interests. So by the time 1940 resolution, in fact, now it appears, I mean, historians have proved that the Lahore resolution itself was drafted in the office of the Governor General, Lord Linlithgow. In his office, the resolution was drafted by an Ahmadi Zafrullah Khan. But because he was an Ahmadi, his name does not figure out very much. But he was the man who actually drafted it. Letters of the Viceroy bring this out. So when it came to 45, 46, Jinnah had convinced the British that, you know, we can't, Muslims and Hindus can't stay together. You will have to segregate. So elections were to be held. And in that elections, Jinnah unleashed the religious card. So the main slogan, because Jinnah did not believe in mass disobedience like Gandhiji did, he didn't believe in labor laws because bulk of the supporters of the Muslim League were landlords. So he unleashed the slogan, which is especially useful in Punjab and other places, Pakistan ka matlab kya? And the answer was the kalma, la ilaha illallah. So once this religious genie was unleashed and people were told that you have to vote for the Muslim League if you are a Muslim, otherwise you will go out of the pale of Islam, your marriage will be dissolved, and you know, all kinds of things, you won't be allowed to be buried, and so on and so forth. So once this religious genie was unleashed, till today, Pakistan is suffering the consequences of that. Because religion is something that once you start playing with people's emotion and say, Pakistan ka matlab kya, which is the kalma, then you know that that is the end. So this is what Jinnah did in order to convince the British. First, and second, till 1946, if you recall, till June 46, Jinnah was willing to have a united India. But because the Congress wanted a strong center and Jinnah wanted a weak center, he broke off all negotiations and announced Direct Action Day, which led to the killings in Calcutta and about 4,000 people died. He wanted to conclusively prove to the British that Hindus and Muslims could not stay together. So that was the kind of legacy which Jinnah bequeathed to this construct which became Pakistan in 1947.
Now, so the day dawns, 1947, August 15th. It is still not clear if Lahore is going to be part of India or Pakistan. And Lahore was probably 50-50, 50% Hindus plus Sikh and 50% Muslim. And the same was the case with Karachi. Maybe Karachi was a higher percentage of Hindus. So how true is the fact that the administration and the local law and order was being managed by Hindus, and that's what left the vacuum that made the military to come in and fill up that vacuum?
Well, actually, not exactly, because the Ratcliffe Award was announced on, I think, 17th or 18th of August, after the two countries, after India became independent and Pakistan was created. So till then, people had not moved. You know, so the bulk of the migration and the bulk of the killings took place after the Ratcliffe, and people suddenly were in Lahore and Rawalpindi and these places suddenly realized they were on the wrong side of the border. Because the Hindus and Sikhs were determined that if you're going to partition the country on the basis of the two-nation theory, then there's certainly no way they're going to stay under in a Muslim country. So the mass migration and the mass killing started thereafter. And you're right, administration totally collapsed because so many people left that the new creation Pakistan was not able to come to grips with the kind of situation. So it was, law and order went totally out. And the British left. The British were asked to leave. So they left on 14th, 15th of August. Of course, in Pakistan, a lot of the British people still stayed on in various administrative positions, including chief of the army. Commander-in-chief of both armies continued to be British. But the bulk of the administration at the lower level, they left. So there was this mass killings and all that took place. Now, the reason why the army moved in was something different. You see, bulk of the leadership of the Muslim League came from India, came from the United Provinces, came from Bihar, came from Mumbai, from Bombay. But the army, Ayub Khan, Yahya Khan, General Musa, all these guys were sons of the soil in Pakistan itself. So it was far easier for them to know what Pakistan was all about and move in to control, rather than the people who came from, somebody coming from Lucknow or Allahabad and landing up in Karachi. He didn't know anything about Karachi or administration, who the people are, how to run. So they became dependent on the civil service and the army who were already there. That's one of the main reasons why the army found it so easy to slip into positions of power.
So in your opinion, prior to 1939, the distribution of personnel in armed forces in India was not 50-50 Muslims and Hindu, or Muslims and non-Muslims? I thought that happened when they came back after defeating the Afghans.
Are you talking about defeating the Afghans in 1990, the Third Afghan War?
When did the British defeat Afghanistan? 1890, 1890, something like that?
No, there were three wars, they lost all three. I think, you know, the thing
you are the expert. I'll let you walk us through it. Yes. My question, sir, is where there was a point at which the British decided that they wanted to pack the army with people from Punjab. Punjab had both Hindus, Sikhs, and Muslims. Go back to 1947. The Indian army was primarily consisting of three groups. Now it is more diversified, but at that point it wasn't, isn't it?
Yeah, true.
So I just want to find out when it started.
See, it started after 1857. During the 1857, War of Independence, the British realized that the people who were most loyal to them were from Punjab. They are the ones, and the UP people from UP, they were the ones who actually revolted. So this whole concept of martial races were people who actually did not participate against the British. And so the recruitment, and as it is, Punjab had this tradition of people joining, and frontier had this tradition of people joining the forces and fighting with various kings, whichever invaders sort of came along. So bulk of the recruitment started from 1957 onwards, gradually. First World War, massive recruitment took place. Almost a million, I think, people from India went and fought in the First World War. Likewise, in the Second World War, massive recruitment took place again from Punjab, from frontier. In fact, there is a book by Stephen Cohen, which says that after the 60s and 70s, 75 to 80% of the Pakistan army came from just five districts, three in Punjab and two in frontier, what is called KPK today. So bulk of the recruitment in the British, combined British Indian Army, and also the post-Pakistan army, came from Pakistan. There were very few people from other parts of India, or even what is now Bangladesh, or places like that. It is only in the northwest, and also because Britain was always worried about Russian invasion, so they wanted to bolster these areas. Therefore, not only were they recruited them in the army, but gave them land, you know, make them settle in various frontier areas and where deserts, so gave them a lot of land. So that's why this tradition in Pakistan continues, where Pakistan army officers get vast amount of land at the time when they retire.
In fact, none of us knew this until Tariq Fateji brought it up in one of his conversations. I mean, this was a revelation. And again, if you listen to Major Gaurav Arya, he talks about how many children of the generals, they don't go to college in Pakistan. They go to either United States or in United Kingdom, perhaps even to Canada. Yeah,
absolutely.
And he was saying, you know, you should consider yourself lucky. The generals, boys and girls of in India, they are fighting to get into DU and St. Stephen's and what have you. Nobody has plans of studying abroad. So there is one book, The Great Game, by Narul. He was the last ADC to Mountbatten. Narinder Singh Narula or something like that.
Narinder Singh Sarila.
Right. Yeah. If you read that book, you know, every page is a new revelation in that, about how the British also aided in the formation of Pakistan. Not only that, they were actually obligated to the United States for helping them defeat Hitler. At the same time, they managed to walk this fine walk where they kept telling US, yes, 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 it will be a united India. And yet got what they wanted, which was to divide India, because they wanted to secure all the oil port, because most of Middle East oil was being managed by the British. I think only Kingdom of Saudi Arabia started entertaining the United States. So there was also that war going on. Who is going to manage the oil of the Middle East, right?
It is called the Wells of Power.
Yes.
And the reason, that's why, Sarilala makes a very interesting point. That till 46, the Chiefs of Staff Committee, Imperial Chiefs of Staff, wanted to have a united India. That their post-withdrawal from India interests would be best served by a strong united India. But by 47, the British started getting suspicious of Pandit Nehru and his socialist views, his likeness or leanings towards the Soviet Union. So they felt that I don't know how long or how much they could trust Pandit Nehru. Whereas Jinnah, on the other hand, was totally open to any kind of British assistance. So even in the case of Balochistan, for example, Kalat, initial British response was to accept the independence of Kalat. And therefore, a tripartite agreement was signed between Kalat, Mountbatten, and Jinnah, accepting the independence of Kalat. But subsequently, when the British realized that if you don't have Kalat or Balochistan within Pakistan, Pakistan would be a very weak state. Geographically, it will not make sense. So then they prevailed upon Jinnah as late as October 1947 to ensure that Kalat doesn't become independence. Likewise, even in the case of Gilgit, initially
Major Brown,
the British, yeah, the British had thought that Gilgit, Maharaja Kashmir, will, you know, sign the instrument of secession with Pakistan. But when the Maharaja did not, and the raiders went in, and the British and the Maharaja signed the instrument of secession with India, it was then and only then, on the 1st of November, a signal was probably sent to Major Brown to stage the Gilgit mutiny. So at least the Gilgit portion, to ensure that India does not have a border with the then Soviet Union, you know. So that became part of Pakistan. So Britain did a lot of manipulation to ensure that Pakistan was a viable state, so that it could control the, or be, have access to the wells of power, to be under the soft underbelly of the Soviet Union, on which they could base their forces, which they weren't sure that a united India would allow.
Now let's take a look at your other book, At the Helm. Can you talk a little bit about what you have in that book? Because it seems to me, from just reading the title, you're talking about all the people who led Pakistan, whether it was the military generals or the politicians.
Yeah. You know, so I've sort of talked from Jinnah right down to Musharraf and to Nawaz Sharif. Basically, I was interested in seeing what role has leadership played in taking Pakistan towards the abyss. That, you know, what were their impulsions, compulsions? What was their behavior? What was their personalities? So I did a study of all the entire leadership and where Pakistan is at. And so a couple of conclusions that I've drawn from that, you know, come that, you know, the kind of polarization in Pakistan today, the kind of, if you were not with me, then you were a traitor to Pakistan. Every important leader in Pakistan has been called a traitor, starting from Fatima Jinnah, which is Jinnah's sister. She was called an Indian agent by Ayub Khan. Nawaz Sharif is frequently called, Benazir was called, and everybody, you know. So why is this kind of polarization? So democracy really hasn't settled, seeped into. And what Pakistan is doing is slipping back into the pre-British sort of administration, where the ruler, whether it's Imran Khan today, you see how dictatorial he is. His word is law. He refuses to believe anybody or take anybody's advice. The civil servant service is not independent. So, you know, this is the kind of deterioration that has happened in Pakistan thanks to this. So it's a complete survey of Pakistan's leaders. And that was my intention, to see where this Pakistan started going wrong and what are the weaknesses among all the leaders.
See, you touched upon something very interesting to me. I thought Imran Khan was more of a selection by the army to be the figurehead title, because there is a Lautenberg Amendment, if I remember correctly, which from the United States, at the time, you know, a few years back, the US was the primary donor of aid to Pakistan. And the US had a clause and said that the moment Pakistan becomes a military run country, all aid from US would cease. So they need a figurehead to make it look like it was a democracy, that there were elections and so on, whereas they could continue doing what they were doing. Isn't that not true?
That's true. But the army at least expected that Imran Khan would run the internal affairs, especially the economy. The army will take care of the security, the foreign policy, defense, etc. But somebody has to run the economy. Somebody has to run the governance. Imran Khan has proved to be a failure in those very aspects of the army. I mean, he hasn't kept his part of the bargain. He was certainly selected for this particular purpose, that he's articulate, he's presentable, he has an access to the West. But he has not been able to deliver on the economy and on governance. He's so focused on bashing the opposition. And the army also realizes that you can't run a country where there's so much of polarization that is taking place, where the opposition is, you know, the prime minister doesn't even want to be in the same room as the opposition. So he's not kept his side of the bargain. And that's the reason why, you know, the army today, I think, is getting skeptical of Imran Khan, because he says, I am on the same page as the army, or the army is on the same page as me. So people are saying that if you're on the same page as the army, then the army is equally responsible for the mess that Pakistan is in. Especially on economically, Pakistan is in a very deep mess. So they feel, for Nawaz Sharif, when he talks to the people and says, Imran Khan is bad enough, but the selectors who brought him are worse, because they chose him and they brought him. And it resonates with the people. They realize, yes, because it was a very bad choice, a very poor choice.
Now, let's take a look at the recent events in Pakistan. Up until Bajwa, army had some sort of a procedure whereby, you know, they would say, okay, there are four garrison commanders, or I don't know what exact regional commanders, I don't remember the exact word for it, but they basically decided that who shall be the one becoming the general of the army. But with Bajwa, two things happened. One is that he got himself a three-year extension, and two, the CPEC contract, the management of CPEC, all happened to be a nephew of his. I think recently he has resigned, but then these things are all, you know, resigning is, so what? If it's a company where the person owns 90%, but he resigns the job, but still he owns 90%, so he's effectively still the owner. So with Bajwa now, you're beginning to see the dynastic ambitions of not just the political families, but also the military families. What are your thoughts on that?
Not really. His namesake is in charge of CPEC authority, Lieutenant General Asim Salim Bajwa. Are you referring to him?
Yes.
No, he's not his nephew.
Okay.
He's not his nephew. They happen to come from the same sort of biradri.
I see.
But he's not his nephew. There could be a distant relationship or whatever, but that it doesn't work in the army that way, that, you know, your son or your nephew or somebody who can push him. Now, Bajwa is following the president's, which is predecessor, Ashfaq Kayani. He also got a three-year extension. And then came Rahil Sharif. Rahil Sharif did not. Nawaz Sharif did not give him an extension. But then Bajwa got an extension from Imran Khan. So that has led to a certain amount of disquiet within the army, because about 20 odd generals who could have bid for the top slot will retire out, or Bajwa will retire them out. So they lose out on an opportunity. Not all of them would have become chiefs, but at least everybody thinks that he can become chief, right? So there is a resentment in the army. But because of this, if the economy was functioning well, if the army was not being sort of pilloried by the people, Bajwa would have been fine. But because there is so much of resentment in Pakistan amongst the people, because prices are high, gas shortages are there, there's so many other things that are happening, going wrong, but the blame is coming to Bajwa. And this, you know, the institutional interests of the army are being affected. And that's something which the co-commanders conference, you know, they are the ones who are facing the brunt of this, because they are the one in the forefront. When their jawans, maybe staying in cantonments, when they go home on leave to their villages, the people tell them, you know, what kind of an army are you serving? See what has happened to us. So they come back and report this, and that goes up the chain of command that, look, there is a lot of resentment within the country of what exactly the choices that we have done. And people seem to feel that Bajwa has linked his tenure now to Imran Khan. That if Imran Khan goes, Bajwa will have to go too, and vice versa. So there is a resistance from Bajwa, but amongst the other officer corps, there is a lot of criticism.